winery in Oliver, and I am here with the winemaker, Séverine Pant. Thank you for having me today.
Thank you for coming. Cheers.
So I guess I'd like to start out by asking you, what is the philosophy of the winery and how did it all come about?
Well, for me, it all starts in the vineyards and coming to the Okanagan and having a new look, I can really see the different pockets of different soil and geology and what it brings to the winery. Mm-hmm. So really what they had in mind at the beginning was just to try and express what Mother Nature is giving us. Mm-hmm. And it's been my philosophy as well all my life, my winemaking life. Mm-hmm. And so what we've been doing here at Le Lépin is trying to look at every block and look at the geology and the type of soil and then really micromanage the vines, mm-hmm. according to how much water the soil is giving back and the exposition and really trying to work in detail oriented and, mm-hmm. and then take what we have from the vineyard and then bring it in the winery and then just let the grapes express what they have to say.
Right.
And that's really the philosophy that we try to.
Because it all starts with the vineyard.
Everything.
Have you found that philosophy has really changed in the Okanagan? Because not that long ago, I think the philosophy was that it was mostly about winemaking, but that has really changed in the last little bit.
I've only been here for 8 years, but already since I've been here, I've seen a shift. At the beginning, I had the feeling that maybe a lot of the wineries were growing grapes, seeing dollars on the grapes, and then harvesting, giving that to the winery and saying, hey, I'm done. Mm-hmm. Do your job.
Yeah.
And now I see the reverse where everybody is looking at what's important in the vineyard, controlling the yield. Sometimes we can do a little bit more, sometimes we have to do a little bit less depending mm-hmm. on the terroir and then kind of the style of wine. And really having that, being conscious of that, mm-hmm. and I think it makes a big difference. And I think the valley is really shifting to that, yeah. to that mentality and that philosophy.
Mm-hmm. So, because of that philosophy, especially here, tell us about the varietals that you're focusing on and why you feel they do so well here.
So, most of our vineyards are from north of Oliver, like just after the bluff, the McIntyre Bluff, and then south all the way to Osoyoos. And when you look at the geology and the climate, we are almost 5 degrees Celsius higher sometimes than even just Penticton, and mm-hmm. it's 20 minutes, 25 minutes away. So we try to focus more on grapes that were adapted to maybe a hotter climate, warmer climate, and they came all back in 2008 and 2009. There was some major frost like early on, and Le Vieux-Pin was producing a lot of Merlot and Pinot Noir. And the Pinot Noir kind of didn't really like the cold and they didn't survive. A lot of them died. And so the owners were faced, okay, well, what do we do? Do we replant Pinot Noir? Do we do something that's more adapted to the South economy? And that's what the Syrah came in. Also, the other varietal, the Pionier Roussanne Marsanne,
yeah.
they're as well a little bit later ripeners, mm-hmm. so they like the a bit more heat in it. And so far, like we've had some 2008, 2009, 10 Syrah, and it's amazing. And then I think the reason why is so we have different terroir, like I was saying, different expressions. Some Syrah can be really flowery, some can be really spicy. And then what we have as well, we have a lot of high temperatures, but we also have very cool nights.
Yeah.
And that's what's unique about the region of the Okanagan.
Yeah.
You can really see that shift here in the south, mm-hmm. and that allows the plant to cool down, to maybe rest from the high stress of the day, and then the acidity, the natural acidity remains in the plant, and then you can really see a difference in the wine,
mm-hmm.
and that's what makes the South Okanagan adapted to grow those later vines like Syrah and Pionier Roussanne Marsanne.
Okay. As a woman in the wine industry, can you share a little bit about your experience, opportunities that have presented itself, maybe potential barriers that you faced?
So, it's funny because I'm asked that question quite a lot, and sometimes I almost don't want to answer because I don't want to make the difference.
Yeah.
Because they accentuate the fact that we're women and we shouldn't be different.
True.
But it is true that there's a major difference. France is a very traditional winemaking country. They've been making wine for years and years and centuries, and it's a very male-oriented industry.
Mm-hmm.
Here in Canada, it's shifting. There's a lot more female winemaker. But back in France, I had to work twice as hard, and I had to face comments, silly comments like, period, you can't come in the winery because the wine is going to turn bad.
Wow.
Or things like that. And it's still there.
That's crazy.
And if you're not from the region, then as a female, you have no chance. Like in Bordeaux, I worked in Bordeaux for a year and a half as more on the marketing side. And I was working with the Pessac Vigne Appellation. And I eventually tried to see maybe if I could have a career in Bordeaux. It was very closed. Maybe that's changed, it's like 20 years ago, but so it's not as easy, and as women we have to juggle the always they have three personalities. I have my winemaker personalities, I'm a mom, so my mother, and then the woman.
Mm.
And then you have to find a fine balance between the three.
Yeah.
And the three makes who I am, Céline, but it is it is hard at sometimes because you're expected to have the same level of excellence as anybody else, but sometimes you have to juggle with many more parameters of the male. So in the end, I think it's a chance because I learned how to be organized. I learned how to try to be efficient and really understand the process so that we lose less time.
Mm-hmm.
And so as a winemaker on the whole, you learn to be focused and detail-oriented so that there's no missed things that can delay things in the future.
Yeah.
So I think, because being a winemaker is, yes, you make the wine and you're in the cellar, you taste, transform the grapes, but it's a lot as well of organization, of planning, saying 5 years down the road, like if you plant a vineyard, you need to know what you're going to be potentially doing in 20 years.
Yeah.
Because the way the vineyard is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you wear a lot of hats.
Yeah, and so it's really, I think it's empowering, and then I like the challenge.
So well, yeah, that's what I was going to say. It probably, lights a fire into your butt to just prove them wrong, right?
Yeah, exactly. So
that's I love that perspective. So thank you for sharing that. I know it can be a little bit of a controversial question.
Yeah.
So but sometimes we have to ask these questions to get the conversation going. So where do you see the Okanagan going, and what are some exciting new things that are happening that you're particularly jazzed about, and what are some varietals that you'd like to see more of in the Okanagan? Kind of threefold question.
So for me, the Okanagan is, as I often think, as a baby industry. Like we're 30 years old, 35 years old compared to some people who are 3,000 years. And it's really, really invigorating and exciting, and I'm super enthusiastic about what we can build. And then we are working a lot on what is the Okanagan, how can we present the Okanagan to the world.
Mm-hmm.
And working a lot on that, and then on the trips that we're doing outside of the country, like we're going to London in May, really try to present the Okanagan as a wine producing region that can produce excellent wine.
Yep.
And unique because of the climate and because of that natural acidity that stays in the wine. And so I'm really thinking, and from the feedback that we have from the industry, from some of the media, some of the restaurants that we're pouring our wines in Germany, London, China, the feedback is this is excellent. This is there's a soul in the wine. There's something that some other region might not have, and then we have it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think the Okanagan as a future is we're going to be recognized on the world map as a quality producing region.
Mm-hmm.
And by the what we're doing, focusing on the vineyards and in working in the detail, I think it's where the economy is going to go. As for the varietals that I see coming in and, with the climate change and those higher temperatures, I really see maybe the South Okanagan focusing more on those maybe bigger reds like Syrah, Cabernet Sauvignon, Cabernet Franc, and some of those later ripener grapes like the Viognier, Roussanne, Marsanne.
Yeah.
And then maybe the north staying too with the Pinot and the Riesling and the Chardonnay where it's a bit cooler and then maybe better for those type of grapes. And maybe having this the south and the
regionality.
North regionality.
Yeah.
I'm really excited about the and that's again maybe stuff that we're seeing, but can be two sides. It could be a positive and negative side. But the positive side is the sub GI, trying to really identify where there's a unity. It was in that really big geology complexity that we have, and so really trying to identify a characteristic of that kind of soil can give more sturdy, more linear tannins, but a very nice structure. Whereas the I'm thinking golden wine when I say that, and then the black sedge bench can be more a little bit more luscious and wines. At the same time, I think we have to be careful in the way that we're going to market it because we don't want to be increasing the complexity for the consumer, on the consumer part.
Yeah.
Trying to really, we have a big role in educating the consumer.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's part of one of the major duty of the industry, of the industry, to try and make more clear for the consumer, say, okay, well, if I get a wine from the Okanagan, this is what I'm getting. If I get a wine from the South Okanagan, I'm getting this.
Yeah.
And then narrow it down to the SFDI and eventually. So I think it's a very long-term plan,
mm-hmm.
30 years. I might not be able to see it, but it's
going in that direction.
It's going in that direction, yeah. That's what I'm seeing.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, we're still in that genesis phase where we're figuring out what we are best at, and only within the last couple of years, maybe 10 years, are we really starting to see those like laser focused plans where you know, wineries like yourselves, Tantalus, they're only producing a couple of varietals because they know that's what they produce best, and less experimentation, although that is still happening, we're seeing less and less of it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
More of an expectation, recognition for what we're good at. So yeah, I see it going in that direction for sure. Okay, well lastly, I always like to finish off with the death row wines question. So your top three. And I know that can always evolve and change. So maybe today what comes to mind, what would be your top three?
So for the red, I would go with the Syrah from the Côte d'Ivoire.
Yeah.
This is one of my really favorite wine. For the white, I would go. You know what? I might sound crazy, but I love the Ava that we're producing with the blend of the Viognier and San Marsan, and I love the floweriness that the terroir gives and that elegance. I would take that one. It has the name of my.
It's
daughter,
a good choice.
So.
Doesn't make you crazy. It's an excellent wine.
And then if I had to choose another wine, I would go for a rosé, and maybe a rosé from the Grenache Saint-Saulve from Provence.
Nice.
I love the Grenache grapes and what they can give. So
yeah,
I'm thinking maybe my desk will be on a desert island, and I'm going to dive there. So
yeah,
a rosé would be good.
That would be part and parcel. Absolutely, great choices.
Yeah.
Well, I would like to thank Séverine and Le Vieux Pin for having me today. And again, Laura with Silk & Coupe, thank you for tuning in.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you.